And to this we shall return in another program with much more exciting things to explore. And I thank you for watching.
Another lovely day begins. Wholesome ghouls with greenish skin. So close your eyes and you will find that you've arrived in Frightenstein. Perhaps the Count will find a way to make his monster work today. He solves this monster mania. He can return to Transylvania. So welcome where the sun won't shine, to the castle of Count Frightenstein.
You little devils, dig this. Tulips are better than wine. I don't blame you, it's pretty bad. That sounds like a sports car screaming to a halt. No. Igor, what was that horrible sound I heard outside? What have you been up to now? You're late again.
I was test snoring a waterbed, master.
Were you really? How very... Do not yawn in front of a count.
Pardon.
Do not cover this button which says our hero's sidekick. That's me. What is this one you have here? Oh, I am a raincoat. Very good. Never wear a button that says you are a person. That would be an exaggeration. But now, enough of this foolishness, for it is time to raise the flag. You're whistling again. And to sing our national anthem. I'll beat it off for you. Hit it.
Gory, gory, Transylvania.
Change key.
Werewolves and bands will always be, yeah.
Back to the old one.
The Becky Moore will likely claim, yeah, as we go stumbling through.
Mm-hmm. I pledge by the sign of the three-toed sloth. It didn't hurt. To do my best, to do my duty, to always obey the laws of the werewolf pack, and to never rest until Brucey lives once more and takes his rightful place in the annals of distinguished monsters. And I can once again return to that most glorious of homelands.
Gory, gory, Transylvania, as we go stumbling through.
Does that make you happy? All right, enough of this foolishness. Explain yourself. What were you doing?
I was outside test snoring a waterbed, master.
It is a very foolish thing you have said, Igor. You see, I have not invented them yet.
Well, master, it wasn't exactly a waterbed.
Well, explain yourself. What was it then?
I fell asleep in the moat, master.
Igor, slip this dunce cap on your head.
Thank you, man.
And sit in the corner.
On a side. Juana Clyde once had a hope. It was his fondest wish to capture for the zany zoo the fabled flying fish. He traveled to a tropic isle and there began his wait. with line and sinker overboard and cans of worms for bait. As Bwana Clyde would have it, he was sitting in repose when suddenly a flying fish went right past his nose. So now, if it's a flying fish you really want to get, you'd be much better off to use an old mosquito net.
Tiny zoo toy! You caught me in the middle of my dance routine. Did you like it? Excuse me. Hello. Yes, it's Bwana Clyde, Batty. Rudolph, knew you. Didn't you like it? Well, I'd like to see you take films of all the lovely animals. Well, same to you, mate. All right. All right, now I would like to give you my impression of the flip-wing Zanzibar bird. Flip-wing Zanzibar bird, it goes something like this. Oh, wow! Did you like it? Well, if you didn't like it, you might just as well say so. You don't have to go and blow your top. All right, now it's time for our film for the day. And we'll find it right over here by the projector. And here we are, reels in place. Lovely. Put the focus on. We always have to have a nice focus. Such a lovely camera too. And then we turn it on. And what are we going to see today? All right, what do we got here? Oh, a nice still shot. Look at that. Hello, you're upside down, sir. And you know why he's upside down? Because this is the two-toed sloth, not to be confused with the three-toed sloth that the Count has, eh? That meanie one who won't let the poor old Igor have a pet. That's right. But he looks a lot kinder, he does. That's right. Now, they're found in forests of South America from Venezuela to Brazil. Now, they measure over 2 feet long, and they weigh about 20 pounds. Oh, look at that. Look at that. I have to stand on my head to get a good look at you, sir. Oh, isn't that nice? Now, the arms are longer than the legs. You see how they hang there on the tree stems there? Very lovely. Look at the fur. My goodness. Must spend hours brushing his hair. Now, they sleep with their head on their chest between the arms, looking very inconspicuous. I say, oh, give us a kiss, would you? Would you give us a kiss? Oh, that's quite nice too, quite nice. Did you like that? I loved it. And you know, we let out our little rary bird, so I think we better get him back in time for his feed time. All right, Tipperary! Tipperary! There, made it that time, didn't break it. But these things happen, don't they? All right, this is Bwana Clyde Batty saying to you, as I have to say at the end of each day, go to your local zoo. You go there and have your own little safari. You'll like it very much, I'm sure. And so I say Ooga Booga, which means when you find your streetcar of desire, watch for the mud puddles as you retire. All right, so long. Bye-bye, mothers.
Pets are friends.
We'll be right back. Meet a commercial.
There's no business like show business like no. Da da da.
The Oracle once told us how in ancient days gone by, everybody dreaded to see comets in the sky. Comets were a sign of doom, a feared by every man. And then he told us how this superstition all began. An ancient king was first to say that comets sure were malice. When one came flying from the sky and smashed into his palace.
Welcome. Welcome. Now, would you give me but just a moment? For my long fingernails are stuck on my board here, and I have to get them out. Oh, I've got to get a manicure, that's for sure. I am the famous and celebrated oracle. Every day, hundreds come to my door in search of my presence. Lawyers, housewives, students, doctors, but most of all... garbage men coming to pick up broken crystal balls. And now we will find out what our sign is for today. All swirling mist that the gods have kissed. Which sign, whose life, will fortune twist? It's coming now. Yes, and it is Scorpio. Yes, Scorpios. Oh, forgive me. Oh, that was a no-no. Remember that, kids. Scorpios are born between October the 23rd and November 21st. Their colors are deep red and black. This describes the scorpion perfectly. Now, let us look into the crystal ball. One moment, please. Not today. I'm onto it now. Now we will see. Oh, magic crystal. Crystal ball, tell me now, tell me all. Ah, yes, you must be willing to take second place, and you must ask questions or you will never learn anything. You should know that, kids. Fortunately, most Scorpios can take care of their deep, strong emotions and let themselves by being ruled by their own minds instead of their hearts. Aha, uh-huh. That's a heavy number, huh? Straighten up.
Gronk!
Oh, hello, Gronk. How are
Hi
you
there,
today?
Count. Say, did you know something?
What?
My second cousin, who is not as long as I am, by the way, just built an unsinkable boat.
That's impossible. There's no such thing.
Sure there is. He built it a special way. It has no bottom.
Oh, well, then for sure it will sink.
No. See, he just got tired of building it before he had a chance to make the bottom.
But why is it unsinkable?
Well, that's one boat that's never gonna float, so it sure won't sink.
Very funny, Gronk, very funny. Gronk. But do you know that there are people who actually did try to make unsinkable boats?
Well, did it work?
Well, this book will tell us.
Oh, okay.
Yes, it tells us everything we want to know about unsinkable boats.
Sure, what's it called?
Everything you ever wanted to know about unsinkable boats. A little humor there from the count, eh? All right, now.
What does it say there?
Well, it says here that a man has tried since the earliest days to build an unsinkable ship.
Sure.
Now, the Titanic was one of the first attempts, you see?
Uh-huh.
Now, she was fitted with watertight compartments, but there was one flaw.
She sank.
Sure. No, she did sink. No, wait a minute. That wasn't the flaw. That
Got
wasn't
to
the
that
flaw.
Time.
The problem was that the doors to the compartments did not seal tightly.
Ooh.
Now, the Danish built a ship in 1962, especially for sailing in Arctic waters. That's where
cold.
They have the icebergs, eh? And she was declared unsinkable, but she sank.
That declaration was false.
That's right.
Sure.
Now, some of the more unusual attempts have been made with the ships constructed of...
Paper.
No, it's not paper.
It's not
Please,
paper.
Will you stop that?
Wrong.
No.
Keep
now,
going there.
Some people have tried making unsinkable ships
from
concrete and ice, but with little success.
Really?
Yes.
That's very interesting. You know, my Uncle Ferdinand claimed he was the world's first unsinkable man.
Oh, he was probably just boasting.
Well, I don't think so. Somehow I believe him.
Well, why on earth would you do that?
Well, he's so full of hot air, I'm sure he could float for hours.
You know something, Gronk?
Yeah.
I don't mind that one. That was kind of a funny joke.
All right,
full of hot air, full for hours. That's
Gronk.
Very good. I'm going to tell Igor that one.
Gronk.
Bye-bye. Goodbye, Gronk.
He who is swept by the winds of individual performance will find his Krishna adapting to him each time he lies down or changes position.
Griselda keeps her recipes inside a secret file. I don't know why, because breaking in would not be worth your while. There's one for chocolate-coated ants, but not the crawling kind. I somehow think Griselda's got a relative in mind. Another called for rabbit's foot. What that means, I don't know. But bunnies should find out, because new feet are hard to grow. The third one was the worst of all, for in that recipe, I found the main ingredient was nothing less than me.
Marching meringue pie? Ooh, heavy. Now here we go. Oh, some more. Fool you around. Put that in there. Oh, boy. Now, the first thing we're going to use here is a little bit of tiger fur. Why? I have no idea. But who cares? It's all fun anyway, isn't it? And edible. There's a little salt. I found the salt finally. Now, we haven't used any buzzard mountain goat milk for a while. Remember that, kids? It really is a winner. Oop, have to take the cap off. Good. Now we're going to just whip that into a little batter. A little batter. That's a small baseball player. You'll be all over the place. It's reeking of it. And now for the final little thing. Here we go. Oh, you found a little friend, and it's a duck. Ooh, quack, quack. It's so cute. And now, as in every pie, you need the most important ingredient of all, a potato. Well, at least I need it. Oh, come on in while I put in the old potato. See the old potato? Beautiful. Now, oh, this is so much fun. I love to cook this dish. Oh, marching meringue pie, just cute. Now we're going over to the old cauldron. Woo, come on. Oh, I hope it didn't hurt my nose. No, it's all fine, just fine. Now, into the old cauldron she goes. Wonderful. Ooh, cauldron, cauldron, toil and trouble. Cauldron boil and cauldron bubble. Oh, it's gonna be good. And now it's tasty time. Oh, I've gotta tell you, that's a gastronomical gas. But come again and see me, and we'll whip up some more things for you. Woo!
Stay tuned for the most frightening part of the show. We'll be back in a minute.
Have you walked your dog tonight?
Do you know who the biggest person in the castle is? It's me.
All right, all right. All over there. This is a grammar raid. Go home.
This is the Grammar Slammer here again, ready to hammer in some grammar.
Every
with
day.
Some help from the Grammar Slammer Bammer.
First a little bammer, then a little slammer, then a little hammer.
And most important of all, a little grammar.
Uh-huh.
What about it?
Well, that's all you know, a little grammar.
Uh-huh.
That's fine by me.
But not by me.
Oh.
Come on, Grammar Slammer Bammer, let's hear a nice good morning for Igor like you really mean it.
A nice good morning for Igor like you really mean it.
Like I believe you.
Wonderful. Now, Igor, and let's have a replay on this, please. Drawing to my attention that you just said, do you know who the biggest person in the castle is? It's me.
Mm.
Now you know that's wrong, don't you, Igor?
You know somebody bigger?
Bammer, slammer, hammer.
I know somebody louder, but that's not the point.
Well, what is the point?
The point is that sentence is wrong.
Wrong, wrong, wrong. Bammer, bammer, bammer.
Okay, okay, I get your point. What's wrong with the sentence?
Well, you can't say it's me. You have to say something else.
It's Griselda.
Wrong.
Wrong.
Is it somebody else?
No, it's you, all right. Just say it differently.
It is I.
Right, all right. Let's see that. Let's see that up the screen. It is I is quite correct.
Bammer Igor tomorrow?
I wonder who he wants to bammer.
Igor!
Somehow I think it is me.
Yeah.
I mean, it is I.
Bammer, slammer, bammer Igor tomorrow.
Oh, that's a winner!
The librarian threw his first party last night, and we're not sure it was a success. Hundreds of people were milling about, and the host suffered total distress. He had planned a small dinner to quietly mark the birthday of Edgar A. Poe, but he wasn't prepared for the mob that showed up with balloons and gay streamers in tow. 163 candles were lit, and the party went into high gear. But what sort of a birthday is called a success when the main guest just didn't appear?
I was just getting rid of that little pest. Away with you, that bat. Oh, you silly bat. Well, now here I am, the librarian. And welcome to my library. There are many tales to be told here, and I will tell all. You will see, I will frighten you. The story today is entitled The Fox and the Woodcutter. A fox running before the hounds came across a woodcutter felling an oak and besought him to show him a safe hiding place. The woodcutter advised him to take shelter in his own hut. It's very kind of him. The fox crept in and hid himself in a corner. Now, the huntsman came up with his hounds in a few minutes and inquired of the woodcutter if he had seen a fox. Now, let's find out if he's a blab or not. He declared that he had not seen him. Good for him, he wasn't a tattletale. And yet, pointed all the time he was speaking to the hut where the fox lay hidden. Oh, he fooled me, did he fool you? My goodness. The huntsman took no notice of the signs, but believing his word, hastened forward in the chase. As soon as they were all away, the fox departed without taking any notice of the woodcutter. Whereupon he called to him and reproached him, saying, "You ungrateful fellow, you owe your life to me, and yet you leave me without a word of thanks." The fox replied, "I should have thanked you if your deeds had been as good as your words, and if your hands had not been traitors to your speech." Your hands not traitors to your speech. I like that phrase. Did it frighten you? Did I get you this time? Did I? Did I? Didn't, did I? But I will. I'll get you. I'll frighten you one of these days. But until that time, go to your library. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Oh, I hate answering the door without combing my face first.
If you're lucky, I'll be back.
Something better is due.
Pet that has a tale, of which I never tire, about the time the animals escaped a ghastly fire. It seems the penguins were the first to notice all the smoke. They set up such a howling that the doctors soon awoke. The elephants were quick to think, for soon as they arose, they filled their trunks with water. Then they used them like a hose. The doctor says he thinks it is the only time he knows that he's been saved from certain death because someone used their nose.
Can't you go? Oh, it's so soft and cuddly.
I know. Guess what I call her?
What do you call her?
Can you guess?
No.
Clowny.
Clowny!
That's right, because she's a Persian cat, and Persian cats just love to play the clown. They just
strut
around there and so proud of themselves. Aren't you, eh, Clowny?
You're not only joking. You told me your name was Hilda just now.
No, I didn't. You're just kidding me. Now, this is a very luxurious cat, and the coat, which makes or breaks an animal as far as cat shows are concerned. Now, the Persians have fine, long, glossy fur. And you should always remember to carry a comb and always keep them well combed, you
can
see.
Can I do that?
Of course you can.
Oh, that's nice.
That's why any of the kids who want to get a little pussycat, if they haven't got the time to brush these little long-haired fellas, my goodness, they should get a short-haired one, you see. Because they always need attention, that's sure. Now, they have a wide range of colors, solid, tip stripes, and partly colored, which is a three-colored coat, you see?
Yes.
Now, for the Persians, there's pure white, black, red, blue, and cream. Oh, that's just to name a few. There's many more. Now, the tip-coated Persians have base coats of white tipped with black. You know, they just walk around like they're just King Tut. King Tut. Remember them?
Yes,
walk around like King Tut. That's right. Now, they're very, very, very good-looking Persians, a massive-looking cat. You see, that's a massive. That will get a lot bigger, this guy.
He looks like a Pekingese.
She.
Oh, she. Beg your pardon.
Yes, of course.
Sorry,
let's have a little respect.
Sorry, Hilda. Oh, we wouldn't have run away.
Sturdy legs. You see that sturdy legs?
That's it. Nice,
Here, give her the pet back.
Sit down.
Give her the pet
back. Yes.
Come on, here. Settle down.
So soft. I wish I could have him. So I could have to play with him.
Well, why don't you ask the slob?
You mean I can keep baby cells, all right?
You go ahead and ask if you can have Clowny.
Okay.
Come on, Clowny, you settle down now if you're going to be with...
Excuse me, Mr. Slug, can I keep Clowny? Just for a day or two.
That's too bad, Igor.
I'm just going to sit here and salt.
Don't you worry. Remember, pets are friends.
I remember. Pets are friends.
Come on, Clowny.
Dr. Petvet looks like a chipmunk.
All right, Boris, you're a very good boy. You ate all your dinner. Now, would you like a little dessert, eh?
Igor, help me. Boris has got me
again. Master, I left the key of the drawbridge. I'm locked out.
Oh, great, that helps. Please, Boris, wait, please. Didn't you hear Igor? I'll just be back in a minute. Hold on.
Coming, Igor.
No, Master.
Coming. Now, Boris, where were we? Ah, yes, I remember.
Igor! Help the cow! The Boris has got me!
Coming, Master!
Help me, please, Igor!
Coming!
Thank you, Igor. You have quite a way with Boris.
Yes, he nearly had a way with you altogether.
That's right. You know what I've got to do, Igor? I've got to invent some kind of distress signal in case this ever happens again.
What about, help!
No. I need something else. I need something else. What about a horn or a bell or...
slide trombone.
Wait a minute. That gives me an idea, Igor. That's right. There it is. All right, Igor, I'm going to the workshop. I'll be back in a minute with a new invention.
Good luck, sir.
All right.
You naughty boy, Boris.
Can't start fighting, sir.
Hello, Master.
Hello, Igor. Well, behold my new invention. All right, Igor. Well, what do you think of it?
I think it's pretty useful, Master.
Yes.
It looks like a hose pipe with two things, one that side and on the other side, and funnels.
Yes, all right. No. What I'm going to call it is, I'm going to call this the Count Frightenstein original man-eating plant distress signal.
That's quite a mouthful, Master.
It certainly is. Pretty catchy title, eh?
Yeah, we could make a song. How does it go again?
Never mind. I never chew my cabbage twice.
Say it 10 times quickly.
Never mind, Igor. I want to prove how this works. Now, here. Pull it. I want you to take this end and stand over there.
This end?
That's right. Over there.
Where?
Over there.
There.
All right, you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. Okay, Boris. Igor, help! Boris has got me!
You're coming through loud and clear, Master!
No, I'm serious, Igor! Boris has got me! Come and help!
Very good!
Come and help me, Igor!
Coming! Boris, you naughty, naughty!
Well, it took you long enough to get here.
Well, Master, it's a long distance, you know, along this long wire from here to there.
But it doesn't seem to work. I can't understand it. Everything I tried to work, it won't work.
Well, Master, it's not a complete failure.
What do you mean?
Well, Master, all you have to do is take this invention and iron out the kinks.
Wait a minute. That gives me an idea. Of course, Igor. Why not iron out the kinks? Get me my steam iron.
When I'm calling you,
go if you must, but come back, ooga booga.
Hey, did you hear about the romantic mosquito with the barbed beak? He was stuck on everyone he bit. Very definitely funny. Oh, lunchtime.
The professor thinks bananas are a thing that should be banned. These deadly things, he said to me, are getting out of hand. I've done a lot of research, which I didn't do for fun, and I found that these bananas are more deadly than a gun. I asked him, are they poisonous? What causes these strong feelings? He said, my son, the danger is from old discarded peelings.
Fear not, I say, fear not.
The sounds which come from this place should not frighten you. How do you do, ladies and gentlemen, and boys and girls, and people, and friends? I am the professor, Julius Sumner Miller, and we do physics. And in this adventure, a new dilemma. Consider the following for you to contemplate. You see, my business here, not only to entertain you and amuse you and excite your enthusiasm and curiosity and spirit, but also to raise some questions which are good to think about. Just as in Pascal we had three vases, so with Julius Sumner Miller, you have three cans.
I'll think about that one.
Three identical cans. Can so, can so, can so, and let them be identical. Somebody says, oh, Professor, you didn't make this one quite fat enough. All right. Three identical. You can have them from some fruit juice or from something. Cans. Now, here's what we wish to do with them. We are going to leave this can shiny. That is, if there is paper on it, we take it off. Here is a shiny tin can. This one we paint black. So we paint it black. Now the problem is already troublesome because I have not said, is it dull black or shiny black? But I don't want to get too technical. It's just black. The physicists who may be watching us on this program will say, well, he didn't make clear which it is, and that's a great difference. And it is. Now the third can has a very thin layer of asbestos, which you know is a good thermal insulator. A thin layer of asbestos. Now what are we going to do? We are going to put identical amounts of hot water in these cans. Hot water, hot water, hot water. How hot? Oh, say 140 degrees Fahrenheit, which is about the temperature of the water you take a bath in. Now, you can put covers on them if you wish. I have cork stoppers in them, in the cans. And then you can put thermometers. So this stick you will recognize as a thermometer, and this stick is a thermometer, and this stick is a thermometer. So they are all equipped with thermometers. And, of course, at the beginning of the adventure, the thermometers read the same temperature. Same temperature. Now, the temperature of the liquid, the water, is higher than the room temperature, and you know what we say, things cool off. Cool off. The thermal the stuff comes to thermal equilibrium with the environs. Question. Oh, this is a question. Which can cools the fastest? Which can cools the fastest? Some say the shiny. Some say the black, because black is a good thermal radiator. How many say the shiny? Oh, 17 million out there say the shiny. How many say the black? 29 million say the black. And do you want to know from me which one cools the fastest? This is where the paradox lies. This is where the dilemma lies. This one, which is insulated. Notice, insulation. I pronounce that insulation to distinguish it from insolation, a point I made once before on a program, insolation, incoming solar radiation. That one cools the fastest. And who would think it? Who'd believe it? And that's where the dilemma and paradox arises. And I shall have to say more about this on the next program, because this is a very mysterious thing. And mysterious things arise in this place. I thank you for watching.
Out of sight.
Help!
over, Gronk.
I am the wolf man. And this is where it's happening, right here at EECH, radio station Yuck, brought to you by the Count and his Dracola. The unthinkable, undrinkable. Yo, ho, ho. Excuse me. Hello, I am the Wolfman. What's that? What do you want to hear? Midnight Confessions. Sounds like a groovy idea, hoo hoo hoo. Okay, you got it, babe. Right, okay. All right, we're gonna hear one that's really a groovy. Way back in 67. Ooh, that's a moldy goldy. But before that, let's have the chime time. And the time will be time to fall in love with me. So I'm not a good shot, so what? Hell with them all. All right, it's TCB time. We're gonna take care of that business. And it's Midnight Confessions by the Grassroots. Why don't we just sit back and kinda dig it?
Very small, very but it doesn't matter too
That's
much.
That's true.
I will elaborate on it later.
All right. Want to get your elbow a little closer?
Beg your pardon?
Want to get your elbow a little closer for more comfort?
Well, why would you want that?
Well, I could go bang. I just canceled your elbow. That'll be 4 cents.
4 cents. Well, put it on the tab.
All right. It's on the tab.
And I borrowed a Band-Aid, too. But never mind. I can't get my mail.
Here's a letter for you. Came in bright and early this morning on a bat.
Good. Thank you very much. And now, what does this have to say here? Dear Count.
Oh, from a relative.
Not necessarily so. Oh, never mind. All right, dear Count, is it true that Bwana Clyde Batty gets all his animals from the jungle? No, definitely not, Leroy. No.
Where does he get them?
He gets them from all over the world. Oh. Not necessarily in the jungle, but on the African belts and various places like that.
Belts?
Well, I really must be going now. So we'll see you soon, eh, Harvey?
Lump, lump. What? It's Harvey Wallbanger.
Unusual. Very unusual.
The castle lights are growing dim. There's no one left but me and him. When next we meet in Frankenstein, don't come alone.
Definitely over. Gronk!